I was about to embark on rewiring, cleaning up and rewiring this motor, and I wanted you all to see this, this wire in particular. This is an as found for my customer. She sent me the motor, the light, the switch, and I don't know what somebody did to this. They've wrapped this in something that's stiff as all get out, and it's peeling like crazy. I'm not sure what this is. I think it's old cloth electrical tape that was wrapped around it at one point. Regardless, whatever this abomination, I can see here it's cloth electrical tape. But whatever this was, and for whatever reason it was done, please don't do that. I'm just going to go ahead and... Oh my God. I don't know if I'm going to even be able to cut that this far back. Let me see if I can find a stronger cutter than what I've got handy here. All right, we're going to call out the big guns to cut this off right here at the... I wanted to call it a grommet. It's more of a vomit than a grommet. This is an... I've never seen it. Oh, my God. There's all sorts of crap in here. You know, I'm just getting my hands filthier just dissecting this. It ain't worth it. All right. Let's take the motor apart, shall we? Let's get the rear cover off. And let me get a container for screws and the like. This is going to, once this is apart, this is going to need a trip to the sink. This is really, really bad. Ooh, well, at least it turns. I did just speak with my customer on the phone. She lives in another part of the country, and she assured me she has never plugged this in, which is good because I don't think she would still be talking if she had plugged this in. I gotta find the screws. Here's one. Get that one out. And I gotta find the other one. Here's the other one. Get that backed off. Oh, this is... gross doesn't even come close to describing this. This is... this transcends grotesque. Alright, let's slide the armature assembly out. See what kind of shape that is in. Doesn't want to leave the housing. There we go. Oh yeah. Nice commutators on that. That is just filled. You can see in the where the space should be for the commutator bars. Focus. It's just filled with grease and crud. That's gross. And let's pull out the worm. The worm is just... Wow. This is, I think this is going to take the cake for, to be one of the dirtiest 201 potted motors I've ever worked on. I'm going to pull these set screws out and just drop them into the screw box. And we'll deal with those after, because this worm is going to have to go to the sink. Elephant snot, anyone? I know some of you guys enjoy seeing schmoo coming out of things, but... And those of you who have your schmoo coffee mugs and schmoo t-shirts, you understand what this is. And those of you who are new to the channel and don't understand the concept of disgusting schmoo, Well, now you're in on the joke. Although this is no joke. Try to extract the brushes from this side. Ugh. This transcends vile. This gives vile a bad name. Like I said, this is not my customer's fault. This is a machine she just recently bought. She's working on the rest of the machine. She wanted somebody to do the electrics. And I believe I came up on one of the Facebook groups as a recommendation. So, for those of you guys who recommend me for stuff like this, thank you. I appreciate it. And I appreciate the fact that you guys trust me to do this kind of stuff on your machines. But, and no, I am not complaining about how this is. This is what it is. But, wow. I can't wait to get the shaft bushings out of this thing so we can give her a good trip to the sink and give her a good deep cleaning. All right, let's see if the windings are going to come off intact. Yeah, they will. There we go, that's plugged out. Now we got to get the brush tubes out of her. I get my brush tube removal tool. I did not make this. A viewer in Canada came up with this, and I am keeping him anonymous because he had asked me to keep him anonymous. If he decides to reveal himself in the comments, that's fine. But all right, we're going to test these to make sure these are okay, but I'm hoping they're going to be all right. Let's go ahead and get the bobbin winder parts. Oh, God, that does not want to come off. Okay, hold on. I'm going to have to change my body position on this. Yeah, that broke loose. And that's loose. There we go. Sometimes these things that have been sitting in there for decades just don't want to give it up. Is that going to spin? Well, at least that's going to spin. That'll get cleaned separately. And the springs actually seem good. That's a good sign. Okay. Spring out of there. All right. Let's attack and get these out of the way. Might get in there. Now, it's obvious I did not run this motor prior to taking her apart. Should be very obvious why. Ooh, nice. Went flying, but it stayed on the bench. And empty bottles galore. All right. Now, I don't normally do this, or if I do, I normally don't show it. But seeing how I break a lot of rules lately, here we go, loosen that up. And we'll loosen this one up. Okay, start on this end. Let me get my punch set out. And let's see, which one do we want? It's too big. go down a notch. And that might be too big, but we'll find out. And that's one size too large. All right, we'll drop her down. Go down 20 and punt. Come on. That screw out, pull these out all the way. Those shouldn't be touching anything at this point, but I think this is just schmoo holding this in place. I'm going to have to take my screwdrivers to the sink and degrease them because they're getting filthy. Oh, great. That's like stepping in dog poo. Let me get a fresh paper towel out. Crap, I dropped some on the floor. Yum! You know, all over most cities, there are signs, at least most American cities, signs, curb your dog. This machine personifies why you curb a dog. Come on, pop through. Pop through. There we go. Get the rest of the way through there. There we go. There's a bushing that needs to be cleaned. And we'll take this one out as well. There we go. And that one's out. It doesn't matter. You can knock out the front one or the middle one first. Does not matter. What would have helped would have been had I taken the grease wicks out before I did that, but that doesn't really matter in this case either. I don't think they were doing much to hold anything in place. So, all right, that crap is out of the way. Wipe that off. Get the poo off of this. Like I said, I'm going to have to take some tools to the sink. These are gross. All right. Let's have some scraping fun, shall we? I'll use the screwdriver to get in here. And this is the reason why I took the bushings out, is to get, so I could get this crud out of this housing. Because this is just so gross and so bad. Okay. Get the worst of this out of housing here. Here's the fun part. This is like icing on a cake. Yeah, said nobody ever. My father used to call stuff like this elephant snot. My dad was not involved in sewing machines at all, but whenever he had to do something that was extremely greasy like this, he's like, oh my god, more elephant snot. And for those of you here in the States of a certain age, I'm sure you'll remember, by certain age, I mean like my age, maybe a little younger, but there was used to be a soap opera on, a daytime soap called Days of Our Lives. And as the theme music would, just as the theme music would start up, the announcer would say, like, sand through the hourglass, so are the days of our lives. And Dad had a sarcastic comment about snot on a doorknob that fit with that quite well. I don't remember the whole thing, but I remember as a kid just laughing uproariously. He was a funny guy. But yeah, now I already threw out at least that much, if not more. And there's an inordinate amount of pulverized crud in here. The grommet, I don't know if the grommet was even there. I didn't see a grommet. I think somebody got their paws in here before and did a number on this and replaced grommet with cloth electrical tape. That's what it looks like. But, all right, well, this is as far as I'm going to go with this before this goes to the sink. Because this desperately needs a good cleaning in a degreaser. So it's going to get hot water, Dawn dish soap, and a nylon scrub brush. A lot of these parts are anyway. Definitely these bearings, or these, I should say, these bushings, and the body and the worm will get that. Ugh. Yeah, these are pretty bad. All right. I'll be back in a few, and we'll tackle this puppy the rest of the way. Okay. Time to start putting this back together. So I've got the front bushing here. Now, you'll note there's the flat, which is going to line up with the set screw, and the hole for the grease wick, which is going to have to line up inside. So we know this is the front bushing, and it's the front of the front bushing because that's where the threaded part is. So we will take, and we will use a little creative tapiology. Yes, I did polish those up. We're getting close. I'm looking down the hole. It's not quite there yet. Not quite there, but close enough, I think, to get. Nope. Not quite close enough. Give it a little tap. Oh, I went too far. All right. Well, going too far isn't that much of a travesty because I can tap it back. I didn't have to tap it all the way out. Let's see how we're lining up on the hole. And there we go. It's lined up. This punch is going all the way through. So we got it in the ballpark. Not necessarily adjusted, but we got it in the ballpark. So now we get to lather, rinse, repeat, and do the same thing with this side. And the little notch goes to the inner portion here. I'm going to look down through the holes here and line up, as you can see. I'm lining up the hole where the grease wick goes, trying to get it pretty much centered, so it's going to go into there. And we're just going to give it a little tapiology. And it's got a ways to go yet. And it's starting to appear. Okay, now we need to use something to, a little bigger to tap her down some more. Because this one actually gets recessed into the housing. And let's take a look. Nope, needs to go a little bit more. Actually, I'm going to go one size smaller on a punch. I think I showed you guys how to do this before. Almost there. I'm going to go one size smaller on that punch. Just to, there, that's a lot easier to keep it centered. It's almost, well, it's going through to the bore. So that's a good sign. So now you have to determine whether or not it's going to be the right spacing by using the worm. Now, I'm going to use, I want a larger one than that. Okay. This is going to be my stand-in for the rotating mask because I haven't cleaned that yet. So I got the right size shafting here. And, come on, Bob. Oops, don't put greasy shit on there. There we go. Now, get the shaft through. Okay, you see how that's a little sloppy? We're going to take out some of that slop. All right. She's still a little sloppy. So, I'm going to put her in a little bit more from the tail side here. Just hold that there. It's light taps, it's all it needs. And here, that moves freely. That's still a little too much slop in there. We'll give her just a little bit more of a tap. There, not rattling, it's nice and smooth, and our grease wicks line up, our grease wick holes line up, so we are good to go. All right, let me pull that out, put these punches away, we don't need these anymore, at least not for now. And you dig through here and find the set screws, and we'll get the set screws in and locked in place. Here's one. Here's the other. This crap can go back in here. We'll address that momentarily. All right. Let's... ahead and get these set screws in. At least get it started, I should say. Actually, that's a little large. Okay. Make sure the screwdriver's clean. And tighten up the set screws that hold that in place. Okay, so we got our motor bushings back. This has got to go to the bench motor yet. Well, it's got to get cleaned and go to the bench motor to get these commutator bars cleaned, so I'll be right back. Okay, before we go through the aggravation of finding out, or rewiring, I should say, let's make sure these coils aren't shorted. First, we'll check here. Do we have continuity there? We have continuity there. And these are not shorted to each other. So, technically, this field coil stands a good chance of working okay for us. So, we're going to start on that premise. There's some old work on here. I'm just going to snip off. I'm not going to try to get the old slobber off of that. It doesn't give me a whole hell of a lot of room to work on this, but we're going to take our chances. Well, we don't really have any choice. Whoever butchered this in this machine's past didn't do the world any favors by the way they did their wiring. So, I've trimmed that sufficiently far back. I'm going to give this a nice tight wrap here. going to go a couple of times around. I'm not going to go crazy on this. All right, that's close enough. I got a good 3 wraps on there. And there's enough there so we can get a good solder joint, and then we'll trim off the excess. Okay. Let that cool off a little bit. Do a little snipping. And a little snippety snip there. All right. Now, I'm going to take a little piece of, a short piece of larger shrink tube. No, maybe not. Strike that. I'm just going to go for what I need here. Get some shrink tube to get over all of that mess and get it all the way back up to the field coil. Got to force it up and over that. There we go. I got it all the way back to the coil. And I got my heat gun. I'm going to shrink it all the way back first. And then work our way up the wire. Okay. That's the first one. I'm going to go ahead and prep the other side. And I'm going to get a few turns on here. A few good tight turns on here. And we'll solder that in place. Same way we did the last one. We'll flow the solder past up the wire that's going to get clipped off. So we'll get a good solid clip on it. Some heat going here. Here I may have put a little too much on there. Let that cool a little bit, and we'll do some clipping. And I guess I didn't. That's good. Just gonna let that cool off just a little bit. Make sure there's no schmoo on there. And okay, that'll be good. Let me grab a chunk. For those of you who aren't aware, I keep my shrink tubing, my working shrink tubing, above my bench so I can just reach up and grab. Okay, once again, I'm going to force that back so it's tight to the coils. And give her a little heat. Okay, success there. Let's push that out of the way for just a moment. We're done with solder for the moment. Get this out of the way. And I'm going to go ahead and put a new grommet into the motor housing. I did, as you can see, take my screwdrivers to the sink to get all that crud off of them. Everything got very filthy taking this motor apart. And okay, That's in there. I need a different screwdriver for this next function. And there we go. All right. Back these out a little bit. And we need the brush, the plastic brush tube holders. Slip those in. And I think that one wants to go onto the bottom. Yeah, I think that one wants to go to the bottom. Come on. There we go. Snapped in. It's tightened up. And pop this one in. Here it goes. That's snapped in now. And we'll tighten this up. Get some of this debris out of the way. All right. Now, I want to grab about, I like using a good 6 or 7 inches of 3/16 heat shrink for this next stage. I'm going to get the heat shrink started. I'm trying to keep the wires as parallel as possible through the heat shrink tubing. Bring that back. Pull this red wire so it's coming through a little bit better. There we go. There. That's nice and straight. That should work really, really well. We'll go ahead and shrink this up. Other side of it. Okay. All right. Now, this is going to horrify some people, I know. Get that started in here. This isn't the horrifying part. Actually, hold on, that's not all the way in. It's not nicely in. I want to get this grommet so it's a little bit more centered, a little more evenly. There we go. That'll work. All right. By the way, this did come up pretty clean. Might not be 100% perfect, but it's a heck of a lot better than it was when we started. I didn't use anything special on this. Just hot water and Dawn dish soap in the kitchen sink with a nylon scrub brush. And, well, a couple of different size nylon scrub brushes, actually, but there we go. Get that pushed through here like that. So, that's going to come across. This one is going to... Let's see, that's going to go on this side. And go in. Actually, hold on, I didn't do something yet. Let me just check to make sure the brushes are going to fit it. Ah, I got to clean these brush tubes out just a little bit. They feel I got a gut feeling that these are going to need a little bit of filing. So, flat file them. Clean them out. Get any burrs off that formed in the extraction process. I like using a jeweler's file inside these things to open them up and clean them up. And of course, I didn't do this when my hands were dirty earlier. I had to wait till my hands were relatively clean, but this is the story of my life. My hands never stay clean when I'm working on these things. So that's going to go in thusly. Come on. Get in the bloody hole. No. Strike that. That goes this side. Come on. Get in the hole. There we go. And that's in. And this one goes in on this side. Come on. Get in there. Now, this is the part that some people are going to think is heretical, but I just put, when I get these wires up to the grommet, I just get a little tiny drop of oil on the inside of the grommet, and that helps get these wires through. It's not going to hurt anything. I don't put a lot on there, just a little drop, and it works a charm. And pull that in. Make sure these wires are routed properly. Okay, what I'm going to do before we go too crazy here is, I'm just going to get this secured. Then we'll get the armature in, we'll put brushes in, and we'll put some power on this thing to make sure it's rotating in the right direction. Because if it's not, I'm going to have to swap the brush tubes from side to side. And honestly, I'm too freaking tired at the moment. I wasn't paying super close attention to what I just did. So if I got it wrong, you can sue me. It'll be right when it goes back. Right now, I'm pretty tired. We had an interesting day today. Liz and I got up early, and we traveled down to Audubon, New Jersey, which is going on an hour and a half, 2 hours south of here, and we delivered the 201-2. If you recall, recently I did a video showing a hook and bobbin case that were absolutely filthy disgusting. Well, that was the machine that went into the machine that we delivered today. And we brought it down and put it into the cabinet. And the charming lady who owns that machine, she had bought it as in the condition that you had seen it in. She was just super thrilled. When she bought, well, actually, I don't know if she bought it or if it was given to her or she found it or whatever, but it was the condition it was in as found condition. She had never used it. She had never powered it up and she didn't have a cabinet for it. So while I was working on the machine, she and her husband found a cabinet, and so we brought it home today, got it into the cabinet, got everything fired up, and she could not have been happier. And we actually cut a deal she wanted this particular treadle cabinet for it, which is fine. You can put a non-treadle machine into a treadle cabinet. The cabinet was absolutely gorgeous. It was beautiful oak. It had a Singer 15-30 in it. So she had bought the machine and cabinet specifically for the cabinet, and I kind of went halvesies on her on it, and I now have that 15-30 that was in it, and she has the cabinet with her 201 in it, and so everybody's happy, and I've got a spare another machine. Like, I really need another machine, but I've got another machine that I can use for demonstrating things, because I tend not to have much in the way of 15s around here, although yesterday I got a call from somebody who saw the magnetic signs on my truck, and she was cleaning out her mother's house. And she says she had two sewing machines and cabinets. If I was interested, I can come over and take a look at them, do whatever. And one was nothing to write home about. It wasn't anything anybody would have been interested in. And the other was a 15-91. And anyway, the 15-91 came home with me yesterday. Not that I need another 15-91, mind you, but it's in a really, really nice cabinet, and it too is going to get refurbished, and will go to a new home. But just make sure these are. But anyway, that's been my day. I'm trying to clean out, get rid of machines from the house, and new ones keep showing up. So, I know a lot of you have the same disease that I have, where they just come out of the woodwork at you. Get that in there. It's going to come out again in a minute anyway. I'll fight it in a few. Just want to make sure this is turning in the right direction before I go too far. So yeah, and I call it an embarrassment of riches sometime, because, you know, I've got way more machines than I need, and I wind up rehoming them, which is fine. I don't mind rehoming stuff. And the nice thing about getting all these machines is it gives me machines that I can use to show you guys stuff. Or at least sometimes show you what to do, sometimes show you what not to do. And at least you can see my thought process, such as it is. There are those that say I don't think. And, you know, they might be right. Because sometimes you just cruise on autopilot. Like right now, cruising on autopilot. Whoopsie. I bought new connectors. When I was out today, I bought some at my local electronics supplier instead of the ones I usually buy from McMaster Car. And these have a little bit shorter of a shank than the McMaster Car ones do. And I got to get used to how much I don't have to trim off, I should say. And give that a good crimp. There we go. That's on, and we'll go ahead and shrink these up, and we'll put it in the power block and see if this motor's spinning in the right direction. It should be, but I just want to make sure. Alright, I still have the light attached to the power block, so I'm going to leave that as such. And just put this in for the moment. I know, I didn't show you guys the wiring of the light. I did a little rant video earlier about the problems with finding switches. And and I went to work on this, and I noticed when Liz and I were having dinner, we actually were eating some chicken nuggety type things and some fresh veggies while we were watching an old movie, and actually watching the movie on my computer. And I did happen to notice that there were some comments that came in on the switch video. Alright, let's plug this up and make sure this puppy is going to spin in the right direction, and I'll go ahead and do the grease wicks. Oop. There we go, the light works. Alright, and it turns in the right direction. Yeehaw! Okay. And the light works perfect. Yay. All right. We're going to end this here. You guys don't need to see me packing grease into this thing. You don't need to see me shining up parts on the bobbin winder. But there you go. Proof positive that we can resurrect even the crustiest, crunchiest motors. And this is good. Today is, well, it's Friday night, so I'll get the rest of this packed up tonight. It's already 10 o'clock. I'll finish this up before I go to bed. And tomorrow, this can go back out in the mail and go back home to Oklahoma, where the wind comes sweeping down the plain. Anyway, that's what I've got for you on this tonight. Y'all have a lovely evening, and we will see you on the next video.